this is going on 10 years now, this one. I worked for the Big 12 Conference, actually three conferences, Big 12, Mountain West, and Southland. And was hired initially in 06 as assistant coordinator of officials for the Big 12. And then as replay grew and grew, we realized through the conference that we really needed somebody to take that program and kind of take charge of that. So my actual title now, still have that one, but I'm not as involved with the on-field officials as much as I used to be, is replay coordinator for the Big 12 Mountain West and Southland conferences. So I thought I'd talk a little bit about replay because it's a huge part of football now. It's here to stay. I don't think we'll ever go back to the days that we don't have replay. And it's kind of taken on a life of its own within the game. It's become a very integral part of the game and a very significant part of the game. So I thought I'd just tell you a little bit about our program. We started initially with the Big 12 and then joined the Mountain West. Really kind of felt like they needed some help. And of course, the Big 12 has more income, more money than the Mountain West does just from television. And the commissioners at the time, you know, were familiar with each other. So we kind of created a consortium and they joined us. And then last year, Southland, which are teams like Lamar, some of the teams in Louisiana, there's like 12 football playing teams. They were the first, used to be called Division II, now it's called FCS. They were the first FCS conference to have replay in every conference, every game. So if you're playing in a home stadium in one of the Southland games, they now have replay. So my role is to train, teach, and evaluate replay officials for those three conferences. And basically, we just have one staff. Our younger replay staff primarily works in the Southland, and as they gain experience, they'll move and be assigned into Mountain West games and into 12 games. There's 15 crews. A crew is two individuals, a replay official and a person called a communicator. And then when they go to a game, there's two other people in the replay booth. And the replay booth is secure. Nobody's supposed to be in that booth, but the four people that are assigned to the game, or an observer or somebody like myself associated with the conference. The other two people are usually local. They're both technicians. One of them is primarily in charge of making sure all the computer equipment works and all the video that's streamed into the replay booth is consistent and the replay official can get to it and use it to make his decisions. In a nutshell, I'll tell you a little bit about what a replay staff does before game. One is they're never with the same crew on field each week. We were going to do that initially when we got this program started, assigning replay crews to on-field crews, but to be honest with you, Mike Leach was at Texas Tech at the time. when they had a coaches meeting, we tried to work with the coaches. He was adamantly opposed to it, and he kind of got a lot of the other Big 12 coaches to go along with him. So they actually kind of argued, and his biggest concern was, if I have replay officials that are with the same guys every week, then are they going to be able to overturn their calls on the field, or they're going to develop a relationship where they wouldn't feel comfortable in overturning the call? We don't feel like that's really significant because, you know, we hope the integrity of all of our staff is such that whatever is correct is what they'll do. But to be honest with you, you know, it's like anything, like in your marriage, you know, pick your battles, and that wasn't one we won the battle. So we agreed to that, and since about 08, I think it was, the replay staff is assigned differently each week. They go to the game on Friday night if the game's on Saturday, just like the on-field crew. They meet with the on-field crew, usually at the start of their pregame. Every on-field crew has usually a couple hour pregame where they look at video and talk about responsibilities and, you know, travel and all kinds of things. But usually the pregame is opened by the replay staff, and because there are different ones each week. Although they work with, you know, the crews, they might catch them one or two or three times during the season. But they go over basically what they're going to do, how they're going to look at plays. Sometimes they'll have some video to show the on-field staff, maybe what happened last week or the week before. They'll go over some plays like that. They'll talk about communication, you know, how we're going to communicate with you, those types of things. And that's pretty much it before the game. And a lot of times the replay staff will stay in and listen to the pregame. And sometimes, depending on the individuals, they'll actually go back to the hotel room. And one of the beauties about replay that on-field officials don't have is every football game, you can practice being a replay official. You know, you could be working on Saturday, you could be the replay official at home on Thursday night when the Thursday night game's on. We tell our guys to do that all the time. You know, hopefully they have a DVR and they're running plays back and forth and looking at it from a replay standpoint and making decisions when they're at home. And they can do that, you know, the whole season. So replay can actually get a lot of repetition that on-field officials really can't get. Basically, they have Saturday. They have falls practices and spring scrimmages and games. But other than that, you know, they get one shot a week and for 60 minutes of game time, and that's it. The next morning, they'll go to the stadium with the Terry told me she's leaving early because she had to go somewhere.
Not
sure.
But
I'm not 100%. They'll go to the stadium at the same time. They get to the stadium 3 hours before the game, just like the on-field staff does. And one of the first things they do is they go to the TV truck. Because TV obviously plays a huge part. Because whether you realize it or not, what they see on their screen in the replay booth is exactly what you're seeing at home. Or in Clyde's case, at the bar. They're seeing the same thing.
They only get 4 or 5.
Yeah, well, they only get one, and it's the game they're working. But no, it's the same video, and it's usually a direct fiber optic line in high definition, and they have 21-inch monitors in front of them. But they go to the TV truck and talk to the producer, and what they do is they go over where the cameras are, because that's really, really significant. And we try to teach the guys that when you're looking at video, you have to understand camera angles, because you're looking at a two-dimensional picture of a three-dimensional occurrence. And the camera angles can play a huge factor, especially involving the lines, sidelines, goal lines, end lines. Depending on where the camera is, sometimes pushes the image away from it or pushes the image toward, say, a sideline or a goal line. So guys have to start to understand that. So one of the things they try to get early on before the game starts is how many cameras do we have and where are they located? And they'll actually have a map of the stadium, kind of a sketch of the field. And they'll make marks. They're going to have a 50-yard line camera. They're going to have two at the end line. They've got to have a cart camera that's going to move up and down the sideline. They've got two handhelds. One's going to be on the opposite side of the field and one on the press box side of the field. So they'll go over all that with the producer. And they'll talk about how they're going to communicate. Because when we stop the game to review a play, the communicator, who's part of the staff, one of the first things he does, he gets on a direct line to the TV production booth and tells them what they're looking for. You know, we're trying to see if the guy's right foot was in bounds as he caught the pass, or whatever it was. And then the TV producers, for the most part, are very cooperative, and they work with our replay staff if we've stopped the game. Now, otherwise, they really don't want to be bothered because they're trying to produce some entertainment. So we instruct our staff, don't call them, you know, when you have a little bit of a delay, unless you're going to stop the game, because it just creates some issues. But once they do that, they talk to the TV truck, you know, talk to the producer, they'll go up to the replay booth, and the two technicians by that time are already in the stadium. Usually this is about 2.5 to 2 hours or 15 minutes before the game. And they'll check all the equipment. And they'll make sure all the lines are set up properly. They'll make sure the communication lines are set up properly. They'll test the equipment. The previous week's game, or however long back it was when they were home, is still in the system. So they'll turn that on and they'll practice using the equipment. There's three monitors in the replay booth. The first one is basically a computer touchscreen that the technician enters everything into. The number of the play, the down distance, the location of the ball, because we keep a record of all that. Didn't quite help us out last week at Oklahoma State, but we're supposed to. And then there's a live, it's called line feed. You think it'd be called live, but it's called line feed. And that's the, whatever you're seeing at home, that's this screen here, and it's in front of the communicator. And it just plays continuously. Whatever's being shown at your home screen, that's what's on that one. And the third screen is a replay monitor. And the replay monitor, the way the system's set up, the technician can, what we call, mark a play just before the snap. And when he marks that play, the replay system monitor is now capturing all that play. And the replay official can then, has a little controller called a job toggle switch, and he can actually freeze it, move the video backwards and forwards, go slow motion, go frame by frame. And then as replays come in, that's what the assistant tech is doing. He's actually pushing a button every time a replay comes up near the live ball, and every time he pushes that button, the computer captures that replay in A, B, C, however many replays are played. if they stop the game and the TV truck keeps feeding them these replays, then he keeps marking those replays. And the idea is that the communicator and the replay official are working together, looking for angles for replays that can be beneficial to the decision process. And it could be replay C, which would be the third replay, or the fifth, and the technician or the replay official on his controller can actually punch a little button. And if it's the fourth replay, that'd be A, B, C, D, that's replay D, he can punch the button and immediately on his screen that he now has absolute control over is that replay number four. And now he can move it at record speed, he can do it slow motion, he can do it frame by frame, he can back and forth. And he goes through that process. If we stop the game, the assistant technician also starts the time of replay. Because it's real critical that we not take replays too long. So he'll actually, in about a minute, start calling out how much time has passed. That's a minute. That's a minute 15. And the replay official is working his dials, looking at the play, making his decision. And by this time now, the referees come over to the sideline. It's called sideline replay assistant. That's the guy with the green vest on. And he's got his headset on. There's a headset in the replay booth that the replay official puts on. And now he's in direct communication with the referee. And the first thing he is supposed to ask, and the first thing the referee is supposed to say, is what is the final ruling on the field? Because sometimes that gets a little confusing. You know, maybe one official will catch and one official will incomplete. So we want to make sure that the staff, as he starts his thought process as an official in the replay booth, knows exactly what they rule on. And then he'll tell the referee what I'm looking for. You know, hey, I'm looking to see if his right foot was in bounds. He has good firm control of the ball. We got that on our first replay. But we're waiting for a down the line, down the sideline shot. That's going to be camera five. And once I get that up, I'll be able to tell you if his foot was in bounds. And once that comes up, he looks at it, makes his decision. And you've heard the announcement that the officials make, the referee makes. And basically, there's three. If he confirms the call, then the replay official is saying that the on-field officials made the correct call, and we can confirm in the replay. And usually, that's all that's said. You know, after further review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. And they might add, it's a touchdown or it's a incomplete pass. If he lets the ruling stand, that means that there's just not enough video evidence in his mind to do anything with the call. And the referee should only announce, after further review, the ruling on the field stands. And then they just go back and mark the ball ready for play. It gets a little more complicated if he changes it, because unfortunately, the referee can't see the video. So he has no idea, other than what the replay is in, as to what is happening on that particular play. So one of the things we ask our replay staff to do, just like we ask referees to do, is you need to practice that at home. If you're watching the game, you're going to change a call, or even if you are, let's pretend you are, you're going to change that to an incomplete pass, then you've got to come up with verbiage as to why you're making that change. And there's a little form they fill out when they make the change, down, distance, location of the ball, the field, you know, the spot, all that kind of stuff. And the referee will always have one official with him that is kind of a scribe. And he's got the same form. The referee will be saying that out loud. And they're going to make this a third down. It's going to be at position two on the field on the Kansas State 45-yard line. And they're writing all that down. And then the replay official is to then say to the referee, all right, here's your announcement. After further review, the receiver's right foot touched the sideline. The pass is incomplete. So that's what the referee will step. And he'll repeat that back to him to make sure they have it correct. The worst thing we can do, and we've had this happen in the past, we learned this the hard way, is he said something and the referee misunderstood it, then repeated it back, and he changes it to his right foot or his left foot, and then he announces that, and then TV talent just hammers us. You know, that was his right foot. What were they looking at? His left foot clearly out of bounds. And so you see what I'm saying? You've got to be real, real careful. And then basically, in a nutshell, that's how it happens. every play in college football is reviewed. Now, there are only certain aspects of the play that can be reviewed. They really can't make reviews on judgment calls. So you could have the worst missed pass interference call at the end of the game in the end zone that may have made a huge difference. Replay can't touch that. There are a few fouls that can be created in replay. Illegal forward passing on the line of scrimmage. two forward passes in a row, a ball that's gone beyond the line and come back and thrown beyond the line, illegal kicking the ball, going beyond the line and kicking the ball. They added a new one this year. It's a very difficult thing to officiate on the field, and that's blocks by the kickers on onside kicks before they're eligible to touch the ball. That's now something, a foul that can be created in replay. Up until this year, it couldn't. So there aren't very many fouls they can create. Most replay decisions are based on two big ones we have completed. That's the number one category, is pass completed or incomplete. And the next one is scores. Now, those are the two major things that replay gets involved with in our conferences that we make the most decisions on. After the game, they've got to prepare a report for me. It's a written report, and then there's also a website called QuickRef that we enter all the data from the game in, all the fouls. The referee does that for the on-field crew. And then the replay official puts in all of his stoppages, and there's a term we use, confirmations, because there are some plays that had he not been able to confirm the play immediately that the call is correct, we would have expected him to stop the game. So there are some plays that he confirms and doesn't stop the game because he's got enough evidence immediately that he doesn't have to stop the game. So they enter all that into the system. One of the things I do in Dallas every weekend is I go through all that and grade all that. So I look at their replays, I look at their confirmations, and then I make decisions on whether or not we as a supervisory staff agree with the decisions they made. And in a nutshell, that's kind of how the week flows for the replay staff. And then it kind of starts all over again.